Just so you know, we'll have you sitting right here.
That's perfect.
Around the world have a soft spot, a heart
just a difficult time to stomach the news that we got about 2 weeks ago. We lost great Gwen Ifill. I know many of you are thinking about her tonight as we prepare to celebrate great journalism and induct her longtime co-host Judy Woodruff into the Hall of Fame. So let's have a moment of silence for Gwen and for the many great journalists we lost this year. And our next inductee this evening also worked at WAGA early in her career, but made her mark as one of the most respected journalists at NBC, CNN, and PBS. Let's look at the video screens, Ms. Judy Woodruff.
Tonight, Americans decide. Voters head to the polls.
Election night 2016. The results of the roughest presidential campaign in modern U.S. history are unfolding before our eyes. On PBS, managing editor and anchor Judy Woodruff, this veteran journalist, the nation's senior network news main anchor, is reporting it all.
It has taken longer to count some of these days.
For more than 9 hours, nonstop, live, Woodruff guides the viewers and the analysts surrounding her, minute by minute, through surprise after surprise, as the votes come in, state by state.
I thought it wouldn't be this tight, but I mean, can you imagine him getting to 270, the Trump case to 270?
The political experts on the panel reflect the nation's blue and red amazement. But Woodruff, the anchor, the rock, simply calmly reports.
We have another presidential call to make. And
with her powerful command of the facts inside the whirlwinds.
Several states are too close to call.
Is Donald Trump going to
Donald Trump is on his way to...
It is 2:30 in the morning when Woodruff interrupts herself mid-sentence. She has blockbuster news and, without embellishment or fanfare...
Associated Press is calling Wisconsin, so that puts him over the top. Donald Trump is the next president of the United States.
And that's it. It is the purest of reporting. Judy Woodruff at her consistent best. At the top of her craft, getting the facts, letting the facts speak.
Introducing you the president-elect of the United States of America, Donald Trump.
So what was it that prepared her for this? There was high school in Augusta, Georgia, then Duke, poli-sci major, class of 68.
And here is the next president of the United States, Donald Trump.
What transformed her into the political journalist that we've always known her to be?
I'm Judy Woodruff. I'm 28 years old, and I've been with Tulsa, having led WAGA-TV in Atlanta for the past 5 years.
Experience and skill, born of youthful self-confidence and talent and drive. Learning her political beats inside out, developing sources, the rough and tough basics. Woodruff's first big break took her to Georgia State Capitol. She was a couple of years out of college when WAGA-TV in Atlanta hired her to cover the Georgia legislature and Governor Jimmy Carter.
Last night's victory came after months of campaigning.
After 5 years, NBC News called. She was prepared, ready for the challenge.
When Carter first visited Iowa 1 year ago,
she covered Carter's campaign for president. Woodruff had recently applied at all the networks. All have turned her down. Until an unexpected opening at NBC's Atlanta Bureau gave her her chance in the field. And her work was spectacular.
Judy Woodruff, NBC News, the White House.
By 1977, after just 2 years, Judy Woodruff was White House correspondent for NBC News. She commanded the beat during Carter's term.
Some Reagan advisors say privately.
And into Reagan's, one of only a few women journalists in what was in Washington then a mostly man's club.
This one.
But it was Woodruff's passion for long-form reporting that would define her career, first at PBS, then at CNN, later, again, and now at PBS.
Good evening, I'm Gwen Ifill.
And I'm Judy Woodruff.
On the NewsHour tonight, Republican candidate...
And And in 2013, Judy Woodruff and Gwen Ifill became managing editors and co-anchors of the weeknight PBS NewsHour.
All the news
viewers couldn't help but take note at the time. A full half century after Huntley Brinkley, Woodruff and Ifill were the first female network news co-anchors. Throughout her career, Woodruff has shattered the limits of broadcast journalism, illuminating complex issues and crises and events and politics in the U.S. and abroad. A light in the darkness, always digging for facts. And Judy Woodruff and her husband, journalist Al Hunt, have helped raise tens of millions of dollars for spina bifida research and care. The first of their three children, Jeffrey, was born with spina bifida. They have devoted their lives to supporting fellow spina bifida families. The success of this journalist's career, begun 46 years ago in Atlanta, is measured not just by the big story she has broken, or even by the unqualified trust she has earned, but by the impact she has on the lives of countless others who are grateful for her and her work.
Halls of Fame are often for people who once exhibited greatness, but the thing is with Judy Woodruff, she's still great. And her work ethic, even during this election cycle, has been one that has exhausted even our highest interns at the NewsHour. She's also a mentor, and she's also pulling a lot of us along behind her, both women and men. Sometimes I pinch myself and say, dear gods, that's Judy Woodruff right next to you.
Your beat obviously inside politics, and I guess in some respects, do you think politics now takes a back seat to what has happened in the country, or do you think in some respects they're using maybe the war on terrorism even as a smokescreen to be more political?
Well, that's a very good question.
Seriously? What do you think of her?
I love Judy.
You do?
I think
you've always been that polished.
She has excellent questions. She gives you a little more time than she gives me, I think.
Yeah.
But she's the consummate professional. She's a bright, delightful presence. She's extremely well prepared, and she is a deeply good person. Right?
For one of the few times, I agree with David, and we both, I think, are grateful to Atlanta for sending Judy here to Washington. I mean, she's just where she is, quite frankly, to the Washington institution.
I agree.
You have always been the Hall of Famer for me. Since you started mentoring me at NBC News, and we worked together covering Ronald Reagan, I'm out on the campaign trail trying to practice what you have always preached, the kind of reporting that is just a Judy Woodruff report. Your work at CNN and at PBS, the NewsHour, everything that you have done, and just being the greatest friend, the greatest pal on the road and off. Thanks so much, Judy, and congratulations.
I'm Jerry Ratchin, and I've known Judy Woodruff since 1970, when she covered Governor Jimmy Carter for WAGA. Judy's talent and hard work were impressive. So one day, Hamilton Jordan, Jody Powell, and I asked each other, what can we do to help boost Judy's career? The answer was simple.
I, Jimmy Carter, do solemnly swear.
Let's make Jimmy Carter president so Jimmy can go to the White House. With hard work, the three of us accomplished that goal with a little help from Jimmy himself. And so congratulations, Judy, on a truly illustrious career.
Hi, I'm Al Hunt, and there's a lot that I can say about Judy Woodruff, but we've been happily married going on 37 years, and I don't want to change that. I will say that there is no place that she would rather be honored than Atlanta. This is the home of her professional beginning, working in local television as a weekend weather lady, which she doesn't talk about a lot, to covering the Georgia legislature, and then going on to NBC, and she loves this city. I remember it was 40 years ago today, when she was a young NBC reporter begging, pleading with the network to send her to Washington to cover the Jimmy Carter administration. They reluctantly agreed, and watching her over these years has been so thrilling, turn from that nervous newcomer into one of the most respected figures in American journalism. She is always fair, and she is unflappable. And it's the same at home in raising three children, but you might strike the unflappable. But she is as accomplished a mother as she is a broadcaster. Her children just adore her, and combining career and family has been so central to her life, and she's done both with such great grace and excellence. So congratulations, Jude. We're so proud of you, and we love you.
A poet wrote, "Truth is beauty. I say, Judy is truth." Never has Judy feared the truth. Always, she's been afraid of missing it. Judy possesses a quiet genius, the ability to listen, learn, explain, write, report, and analyze fairly. Your legacy is truth. Rose petals on your shoulders.
And thanks to all of you for watching. Good night.
The pure, powerful reporter at her consistent best, at the top of her craft, letting the facts speak for a nation never more in need of truth. Judy Woodruff, 2016 inductee, Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
It is my honor and privilege to welcome former First Lady Rosalynn Carter to the podium.
Be here tonight to have the opportunity to introduce one of the most respected and beloved journalists of our time, our next honoree, Judy Woodruff. I have known Judy for a very long time, since 1970, just as Jerry Rush came. When she was a very young reporter in Atlanta covering Jimmy's campaign for governor. I didn't know Judy was around. I knew she was around, but I didn't see her very often because I was off campaigning on my own. Driving from one town to another, passing out brochures, looking for the press, newspapers, not much TV back then, radio stations. I remember turning down a driveway, riding toward an antenna the first day I went campaigning in Florida to see if I could do that in another state. We found the radio station with one person playing music, and I told him that my husband was running for governor, and I wanted him to interview me. And he said, "What in the world am I going to ask you?" And I said, "Well, I have a list of questions." And when the first day was over, we saw a lot of radio stations. We went looking for antennas after that. And ended up at five stations on occasion, but that's too much about me. I'm going to talk about Judy. I best remember Judy from those early days when she covered Jimmy's inauguration as governor. A few years back, a TV station in Atlanta, well, it was actually a good while ago, and a TV station had moved out. And when they moved a large piece of furniture, they found a video of Jimmy's inauguration. We were sitting on the platform, and there was Judy standing down doing her job. And I thought that day, I thought she is really beautiful, and she's got this long hair that turns up at the end. You see me pictures. 5 years later, it was Judy who convinced her bosses at the network that they should pay some attention to this man from Georgia who said he was running for president. And she did the first profile on Jimmy that aired on NBC. But as you probably know, or as you do know, Judy's instinct about Jimmy's potential was right on target. And as her reward, she got to live in a motel in America's Georgia for 3 months, covering our transition to Washington. Journalism is such a glamorous business. NBC made Judy chief White House correspondent during her years there. She covered my trip to Latin America soon after Jimmy became president. And you can imagine how good it was to look up at the press, had a cadre of press myself by then, and see Judy's face among that sea of male faces. Judy was one of those hardy reporters who filed stories from the cozy inn in Thurmont, Maryland, during the ups and downs of the long Camp David summit in 1978. She stuck with it through all those 13 days and was at the White House when Prime Minister Reagan and President Sadat signed the peace accord. I'll never forget that day. Mrs. Reagan and I had been at Camp David, and we went into town because there was a concert at the White House that we had planned before we knew we were going to be at Camp David for 13 days. And we were standing at the top of the steps outside the Blue Room when the elevator with the men coming back from Camp David landed in a helicopter on the lawn at the White House, South Lawn. And Prime Minister Reagan got to Mrs. Reagan before Jimmy got to me, and he said, "Mama, we're going to go down in history for this." Did you hear that, Judy? I wonder if you heard that. Jim and I take credit for Judy's long and successful marriage. During the 1976 campaign, members of the campaign staff in Plains would play softball against the press corps. Judy met her future husband, Al Hunt, who was a reporter, as you all know, on the softball diamond at Plains High School. Our campaign staff usually won those games, as I recall. But the press players complained because we are those big athletic Secret Service guys on our team. Still, I think Judy and Al were the big winners there. Judy has been a fine journalist for a long time now, and she has covered just about every subject you can imagine. I especially appreciate her reports on mental health and stigma, which I have worked on so long and which is near and dear to my heart. Now, we all respect and applaud Judy's excellent work, well read, and you've heard these already tonight. WAGA, NBC, CNN, Frontline, The News Hour, A Generation Next. It's my pleasure to present you with this plaque, representing the recognition and the esteem of our peers and of all of us here tonight. Congratulations, Judy, on your induction into the Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
Carter, I am so honored that you are here tonight and so appreciative of what you said. You know, the truth is if we had followed Rosalynn Carter during that campaign back in 1970, we would have known a whole lot more about what was going on than following her husband. And she's absolutely right about the motel in Americus. But Mrs. Carter, given the schedule that you and President Carter keep, what is it, 20 countries every 2 weeks? Something like that. I am just especially grateful that you made time to be here. I have to say again, for the extraordinary contributions that Mrs. Carter and President Carter have made, for the work they continue to do from one overlooked part of the world to another, to improve the lives of people who are least able to do for themselves, for the work that you have done, especially in the field of mental health, for the difference that you've made. I want to ask everyone to please give Mrs. Carter a hand. Told my story about the softball diamond. It was where Al and I met. He was with the Wall Street Journal, and they had sent him down to cover then Governor Carter. I was covering him for NBC. And one thing I want to point out is that it was the press corps against what was supposed to be the Carter staff, but you never saw people like Jerry Rapshoon, who's here tonight. Where are you, Jerry? Or Hamilton, the late beloved Hamilton Jordan or Jody Powell. You saw the Secret Service agents, so the press, we never had a chance. And I just want to start out by thanking and honoring tonight's other honorees. Bud McEntee so admirably ran coverage. I love hearing those stories about what you did to lead that great news organization as long as you did. And it, as somebody mentioned, it was where a few years earlier I worked covering Governor Carter. But congratulations on your impressive body of work. Still to come, you'll hear about Gene Patterson. I was so lucky to know that great man for the last 25 or 30 years of his life. And John Smith Sr., editor of the Atlanta Inquirer. You're going to be hearing about him. It was the new kid on the block back when I was in Atlanta, but it was already having an impact and making a difference then, and I know it's gone on to make an enormous difference over the years. It is such a treat for me to be back in this city that is so important to me, to reconnect with so many friends here tonight, to be with people like Zernona Clayton, who's sitting right here, with Pat Mitchell, and so many others. It's just a night that I have loved to be part of. And I'm just incredibly honored to be inducted into this wonderful Press Club Hall of Fame. Such an esteemed group you've already recognized. It includes my former NewsHour colleague, I have to say her name, Charlene Hunter-Gault, whom you honored last year. I'm honored not only because this is what you get when you've been doing something for so long, they don't know what else to recognize you for, but also because this truly is the city where I cut my teeth as a reporter, where I learned what journalism can and should be. It was here that I learned to watch carefully how Bill Shipp of the Atlanta Constitution, another Hall of Famer, did his job, asking politicians tough but fair questions. Where I observed the late beloved Ray Moore, television newsman, mentor to me, insisting that a reporter's work is never done, that you not only have to have two sources for every piece of original reporting, but that journalists play a critical role in the civic life of a city, of a state, and of a nation. And Bob Brennan, another mentor, who hired me for my first job as a reporter at WAGA and kept me humble, reminding me to take nothing at face value and that there's almost no story that can't be written better and shorter. Of course, it is also the city where my first boss, the news director at then WQXI-TV, told me after he'd given me a job as the newsroom secretary right out of college, he said, "Besides, how could I not hire somebody with legs like yours?" And who was succeeded by, you'll notice I'm not naming any of these individuals, who was succeeded by a news director who, whenever I mentioned that I wanted to learn more about reporting, I wanted to follow reporters around to understand how they did their job, he responded, "But Judy, we already have a woman reporter." But I eventually did get a break, and I learned so much in my time here, even without the access that I really wanted, Mrs. Carter, in the administration of your husband, Governor Carter. Enough that when, 40 years ago, NBC News asked me to join their White House team covering the incoming Carter administration, I had enough confidence to say yes, but enough humility to know that I still had so much more to learn. And that brings me to one more mentor who is here tonight, the human dynamo and fellow Hall of Famer named Tom Johnson, who's sitting right there. Who persuaded me to go to work for CNN, where under his leadership and the leadership of Ted Turner, I was given an incredible opportunity to be part of an international news gathering organization, a place that broadened my horizons and became the place where I learned so much that I never could have learned in the circumstances where I was. And along the way, Tom and I became very dear friends. Both he and his wife had went, and I'm so thrilled that both of you are here tonight. But I'm so thankful over the years for having that front row seat, we like to say the journalists have, a chance to cover the peace talks at Camp David, the aftermath of terrible events like the 9/11 attacks, the financial collapse in 2008, to report on 11 presidential elections over the years. Because all of this has given me a window into humanity and a chance to deepen my understanding of the best and the worst of our world. In that spirit, I want to dedicate my participation this evening to my dear friend, colleague, and NewsHour co-anchor, Gwen Ifill, whom, as you know, we lost 2 weeks ago. She's left a big hole in my heart and in the hearts of so many others. I call her a supernova. The tributes to her have poured in from literally everywhere. Gwen and I were the first women co-anchors of a national newscast. We sat beside each other every night, along with political conventions you saw at debates and election nights. I said at her funeral that we didn't look like other anchor teams, and we love that. We grew so close, we joked that we were like an old married couple. At first, we would email each and every night to make sure we weren't going to be wearing the same color on the air the next day. We couldn't be the Bobbsey twins. But at some point, we began to intuit what the other person was thinking. So no more emails titled Wearing Red. We would just show up, and somehow our jackets never clashed. Gwen broke through barriers in her moves from newspapers to television and eventually to PBS. I faced barriers as a woman. Gwen faced higher barriers as a woman and a person of color. She will always be an inspiration to those who question whether there's a place for them in the highest ranks of our craft. That and what Gwen loved about journalism and believed that it could be, is her enduring legacy. She, like most of us, went into journalism, as she once said, because she always thought there'd be new and exciting discoveries just around the corner. She gravitated to covering politics because she loved this country, and she cared about where it's headed, and because she was good at asking those tough questions. But they weren't tough for the sake of being tough. She said in a commencement address at Wake Forest University just 3 years ago that her years spent covering politics had made her skeptical, but not cynical. You see, cynics think they know the answers already, and then they stop listening, she said. Skeptics always have more questions to ask, but we are willing to be persuaded to the honesty of an alternate point of view. We have never needed journalists like Gwen Ifill more than we do today. Reporters who are firm but fair, who hate making mistakes but admit it when they do, who hold public officials accountable, who understand how much is at stake as leaders make decisions that affect the world that we live in today and the world that our children and our grandchildren will inherit, who live by the creed without fear or favor. Why? Because the way Americans get news has changed so dramatically in a short time. It's coming at us a lot faster, but in smaller bites and tailored to our opinions. Fewer of us are open to hearing another side. Our country is growing more divided, not just by race and income level, but by our political views. We are moving into enclaves where we may never have to encounter someone who sees the world differently from the way we do. At the same time, we journalists are confronting issues that never used to cross our minds, like how to understand the people we cover based on what they tweet, and how to handle information that emerged from an unfriendly foreign government's hacking into our campaign email systems. More than ever, we need young, smart young people to go into journalism and news organizations that are viable and prepared to support them. More than ever, we need the best and the brightest in the tradition of Gwen Ifill, who was the essence of the kind of journalism we want to practice. And that calls to mind a bond that strikes me here tonight with Gwen, who was the most prominent African-American journalist in this country, with John Smith Sr., who gave African-Americans a voice when they otherwise didn't have one, and with Jean Patterson, who fought bigotry and bias and was a central part of the city that was too busy to hate. Now, as much as then, we need a sense of reconciliation as championed by these three great journalists. That is a mission for all of us in these days and months ahead. Thank you, Atlanta Press Club, for this wonderful honor.
CNN, where are you? PBS, stand up. Let's see all the family members, NBC. Everyone who's here, support Judy. And that concludes tonight's ceremony. Thank you again to all of our wonderful sponsors on behalf of the Atlanta Press Club. Thank you for attending this Hall of Fame dinner. Have a great evening. Stay safe. Yeah.